So today, a little bit of a different video because Eric has made a book. Also, you slice components through and you got so good at it that you made a book of the pictures.
That's right. Let's take a look at some parts here.
So you slice your resistors.
More resistors.
Yeah, it starts with resistors, then it gets more and more involved. But even resistors are impressive capacitors.
Some other good ones. Polymer, chip capacitors, transformers. Oh, look at rectifier bridge. We've got some chips in here. More modern chips. Yeah. These are very complicated inside. Some sensors, ambient light sensor, image sensors, motors, connectors, and cables too.
Yeah, even cables are beautiful.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the cable section. That's got some fascinating subjects in it. And then, of course, we have a whole section here on retro tech.
Yes!
So, vacuum tube.
That's got to be one of my favorites. You cut through a CRT.
Camera flash bulb. CDS cell. Some older integrated circuits.
Oh, 702! The alternate reality, the IBM SLTs.
Very complex multi-layer circuit boards like this.
Yeah, I love this one.
Micro SD card. Did you know it has a circuit board inside it?
And I didn't know the chip went from here all the way to there.
One end to the other end.
Yeah, don't bend it.
And so this is, of course, the cover photo here where there's the cross-section of the smartphone circuit board where you can see that it's a very three-dimensional structure, lots and lots of layers. Another good one is this isolation amplifier, which is just a work of art.
So beautiful.
So we have some close-up photos of that, which are just breathtaking. And then we also have an entire section on here on how we did it.
So. And I shot a little video on how you did it, so that's what we're going to go to after that. Those of you who follow the channel are familiar with Eric, who repaired our ailing IBM PS2 using his magic finger and a great deal of expertise. He is a repeat offender when it comes to crazy retro electronics projects. He's the creator of the Monster 6502, a fully working replica of the 6502 processor made out of real transistors. In the same vein, he and Evil Mad Scientist created this extra-large version of the 555 timer, which you can buy in a kit. When he is not on this channel, he chronicles his electronics adventures on Twitter, where he is known as Tube Time. And that's where it all started, when he got curious about a failed tantalum capacitor and wanted to see if he could find the cause by looking inside. He could not see an obvious failure, but the picture was a hit, and that got him started slicing into all sorts of electronics components. He teamed up once again with talented photographer and entrepreneur Windell Oske from Evil Mad Scientist, and after years of work, the result is this book. To learn more about it, I went to interview Eric and Windell at Evil Mad Scientist's headquarters.
Hello!
Hello! Well, this looks very promising. I see some of your projects, your common projects, the NE555. So this is Windell and this is Eric. And you have the Monster 6502. Oh, you have Maxi and Mini versions.
Yes, we have the DIP and SOIC versions.
This was my first time at Evil Mad Scientist Labs, so Windell gave me a short tour first.
This is our manufacturing workshop.
So Windell designed this modern rendition of an HP pen plotter, which he builds right here. People use it mostly for artistic endeavors nowadays. You just plop it down over the paper, connect it to a modern computer, and away you draw.
Yeah, so this is the base for that SE-A3 that I just showed you, and it's milled from a big solid block of aluminum.
But let's go back to our book.
It actually started out as a repair project. So I had a broken piece of test equipment, and during the troubleshooting process, I discovered that there was a tantalum capacitor that had failed in a short circuit. And so I thought, well, why don't I try cutting it in half to see if it looks different than a normal tantalum.
Yeah, you want to know why it failed, right?
Exactly, failure analysis.
And then you made an incredible picture of it. Can you show it?
Yeah, so let's go ahead. So this is actually not the same tantalum capacitor. I couldn't see a burn mark or anything that looked like a failure, but it looked really interesting inside. And so I put the photo up on Twitter, and everyone else thought it was really, really interesting. And that kind of kicked off the whole thing, because then I started taking other parts and cutting those in half and putting those pictures on Twitter.
If you wanted to show off this one that's in the photograph here.
Yeah. And how do you manage to cut it?
Believe it or not, this is cut using sandpaper. So I just take the intact part and take a piece of sandpaper, a pretty rough grit, and then just start sanding.
So then you guys went sort of crazy and started to cut through everything. So this is a quartz crystal, mm-hmm. which I didn't know actually was a tuning fork when it's low, really low frequency.
It's very literally a tuning fork. It's a carbon film resistor, and it has at its center a ceramic rod that is tumble finished, and it's coated with a carbon film. And they saw this helical spiral cut through the film to make a long track of carbon. This is a 15 turn trimmer potentiometer.
How the freaking hell did you cut through that without breaking it?
Very slowly with sandpaper.
Sandpaper too? Yeah. So you go through a whole bunch of capacitors. This one is really neat.
The hardest part of this one was that we wanted to find a capacitor where you could actually see the layers in cross-section. Uh-huh. And mm-hmm. many of these have thousands, perhaps hundreds of thousands of layers in a package this size.
That was one of your favorites.
Yeah, this is one of my favorites.
I like it too.
Yeah, and we may actually use this as one that we show you how this saw cut is made. So this was cut on our low-speed diamond saw. These layers of polyester plastic, they're plated on sides with aluminized polyester, which is also just called mylar usually. This is an inductor, and our context picture for this is actually on the floppy drive from an Apple IIc computer.
Oh, this is a very noble inductor.
It is.
And yeah, a lot of these boards that we use for context photos came out of my vintage computer collection.
But then you go over to the active, and that's the 1N4002, the most common of diodes. And that's so pretty inside.
And there's this black case that's filled with little bits of silica that you can see inside.
And the silicon dye is sandwiched in the middle, right?
Yeah, right there in the middle. And it's got a little bit of silicone on either side to kind of seal it in there.
Yeah.
It's part of the manufacturing process.
This was a really, really tough subject. And we did a lot of tries cutting this. The inductors don't want to stay together as you cut it. And we cut this with a diamond saw. It's a really neat one because this particular inductor turns out to have 5 different diameters of wire on its windings. And you can see them all when you look inside. Mm-hmm.
It's just fantastic.
Okay, red LED right here. This is actually one of those cases where using the sandpaper and great care and patience really pays off, that you can cut something to exactly the right depth.
I had to sand it and then look at it under a microscope and then kind of adjust where I was putting pressure on the part. So I just sand through just the parts that I want and get the angle just right so the bond wire is intact. And that's how I did it.
But enough talking, let's cut through a few in the lab. Eric and Windell will demonstrate the two techniques with the slow speed diamond saw and with sanding.
A vintage carbon composition resistor.
Go for it.
All right.
Got the flat fingernails many times.
And we're starting to get through to the inner layer here. Mm-hmm. This is probably close enough.
Yeah, I was expecting it to go through it in like 2 seconds, but no.
That is the low speed saw. It doesn't sting.
A little bit of that on there, and let's wet sand it.
Oh, isopropyl alcohol, not water, huh, for wet sanding. I didn't know that trick.
ready to go finer grit. Next one will probably go 2500, and then we'll go up from there.
The book altogether, how long have you been working on it?
Ever since 2019. So,
three years of polishing.
This is 7,000 grit. So we're going to try and get this as smooth as we can.
While we were not looking, it jumped off.
I did a rush job of mounting this sample, and the beeswax came off of the aluminum. I probably should have cleaned the aluminum first.
Well, no cut-through capacitor this time, but we'll solder on with the resistor.
It's usually a trade-off between focusing and moving the actual part. And then we want to get the reflection in view.
Well, here we go.
Okay, not terrible. Actually, let's try that color too. I love this red background in certain things. Nah. Okay, and we don't quite have enough focus on this. We're a little out of focus mm-hmm. in the back here, so let's go ahead and do a focus stack of it.
Focus stacking is a method of obtaining greater depth of focus by taking several pictures of the object while moving the camera a tiny amount each time, then combining the resulting picture's sharpest regions in the final image. Windell designed this robotic camera translator to move the camera precisely between each picture. Many of the pictures in the book were obtained this way. And here is the final focus stacked picture. You can imagine it takes a great deal of effort to make a book full of these. You get to see the grains and everything.
That really pops now.
And I even got to see the cut-through CRT, which is from a vintage video camera viewfinder. They had to take it apart and cut every part separately, then put it all back together. Finally, I had given them one of my failed HP 9825 LED displays and asked them if they could take a good picture of it, because this is the best I could muster. And look what came out. Anyhow, you get it. I think Eric and Windell are very talented. And I'll put a link for the electronic or the hardcover book in the doodly-doo, if you ever fancy getting your own copy. See you in the next episode!